Yeah, so the last weeks I played PicoCTF, which is a beginner-friendly challenge. At least was 400 points, and I'm going to show it to you. So here, it's an RSA challenge. We could look at the hint, but we're not going to do that. So in RSA challenge, we get a Python code to generate the output here. So first, we can first look at. Here's the Python code. Can check the output. So output, we have a large number x, a large number n, and n is standard in RSA challenges. That is the public key of RSA, n and the number e. And the number e is usually, we can see it in the source code, what e is. It's 2 raised to 16 plus 1. And C is the ciphertext. So our goal here is to decrypt this ciphertext. And get the flag. But since we only have n here and this mysterious number x, if we only had n, it would be impossible to crack this. But we also have x here, and when we have both n and x, there will be a mathematical way to calculate the necessary numbers to decrypt C. So I'm going to show you how this is done. So let's check the Python code. It uses bin ASCII to convert ASCII text to hex. And then some functions from GMP, that's the GNU multiprecision library for Python. That's a library for calculating with big numbers. Usually, in a CPU, you only can calculate with 32 or 64-bit numbers, but these numbers are much larger when calculating with crypto. In this case, numbers that are 1024 bits long, and these two are multiplicated together here, and then you get an even larger number, a number that is like 2048 bits long. So you'll need something, a big num library like GMP. So the greatest common divisor, that is the largest number that is two numbers are divisible by. For instance, if you have five and 15, both these numbers are divisible by 5, evenly divisible by 5, and GCD of 5 and 15 will return 5. And this LCM, that's the least common multiple. If you have two numbers, that's the smallest number that is a multiple of those two numbers. Okay, so it's open this flag.txt file on disk and return it here as a string. And here, flag.encode converts this string in Python 3 to a byte string or a byte array. Hexlify converts this byte array to hex. Yeah, using the ASCII table. And this int comma 16 converts this string from or byte string from hexadecimal format to an integer. And this 16 tells it that it's hexadecimal format. Right, so now we have flag as an integer. So flag is going to be encrypted here, down here, and then printed the encrypted flag here to send it out. Seed is used to seed the random state of GMP, and the function here is that is using this random is this MPC urandom b. So bits here is 1024, so I guess it returns a 1024 bit large number. And this thing here makes sure that the leftmost bit, the most significant bit, is 1. This is perfectly good. Maybe the seed is a little bit too small, because if you have access to the source code, you only have 2 raised to the 32nd degree and number of combinations. That's about 4 billion combinations. You could actually loop through all 4 billion combinations here and guess P and Q, and only one P and Q, and then try to decrypt the flag with those P and Q, and only one P and Q will give a correct string on the flag format. the flag format of PicoCTF has the string PicoCTF in it. So you could, for instance, to decide if a candidate decryption is correct, start with checking if it has only ASCII characters in the decryption, then it might be the correct one, and then go on to check if the flag format is in there, with the PicoCTF string. So then hopefully after 4 billion tries you will only find one candidate that is the correct flag. But that is not the intended way to solve this, because here in normal RSA you calculate number n, that is p times q, and this is perfectly safe. If p and q are large numbers like 1024 bits, then it's impossible. If you know n, it's almost impossible if you don't have a quantum computer to calculate p or q. But here we also have x, which is p plus q, and with some mathematics, yeah, maybe we can calculate p or q knowing both n and x here, and this is the intended way to solve this challenge. And then this is a red herring. Usually when the RSA works like this, you choose a number e, which I think should be just any prime number, but usually this is the standard number to choose, it's 2 raised to the 16 plus 1. But you could also choose a small number like 3, but if you choose a small e, there are some attacks that can be done against RSA, like for instance Hostad-Brostad broadcast attack. Here's the red herring. Usually you choose e and you calculate d. Usually when calculating d, you take the Euler's totient function, which is p minus 1 times q minus 1, and then calculate d, yeah, using e, the modular inverse of e modulus phi, and phi is the Euler totient function. But here instead they use LCM, and googling a bit you can find here that here's Euler's totient, it's like I said p minus 1 times q minus 1, and here's the Carmichael LCM function, at least common multiple of p minus 1 and q minus 1, and it turns out that you can use either one, either this lambda or phi of n, and the decryption will still work because of some number theoretical magic. And if you're interested exactly how it works, this is the number theoretical foundation. You need to understand those four lines. If you don't understand it, then I recommend go to a place like Khan Academy and check out the videos on number theory. And I think he even has a couple of videos on RSA. And if I haven't seen them myself, but I would guess that he explains in his videos this method, how to use Euler's totient function and how it works with RSA. Check. Yeah, step 1, step 4, step 2, so I guess if you check first step 1, 2, and step, find step 3 and step 4, then you will understand the RSA encryption using Euler's totient function here. But if you also read this on cryptostackexchange.com, you will also understand that this Carmichael function can be used instead of Euler's totient functions, and the decryption will still work. Okay. So this is a red herring. What you really need to do is just factor n, and that means calculate p or q. Once you have calculated, for instance, p, then q is easy, because q will just be n divided by p. And because of this, you know that it will be an integer, because p is an integer, q is an integer, n is an integer. So n divided by p will be an integer, and that will be q. And all those are fast mathematical operations. Okay, so how to solve this? X is printed, p plus q, n is printed, p times q, and then c is printed. But first we need to calculate p or q. So I'm going to show on pen and paper, with pen and paper now, how to calculate p when we know both x and n. We had, what had we, x was q plus p, and n was q times p. For instance, take p here and put it inside here. Or even better, if we want to calculate, we can do that, and then we can calculate q. We want p on one side, then p is x minus q. So if I replace p here with x minus q, I get times x minus q. Okay, great, because now there's only two unknown. There's only one unknown. N is known, x is known. X is in two places. No, that's not x, that's times. Let's write a star here. Let's multiply this in, and we get n is qx minus q squared. Yeah, so this n and x are known, it's only one unknown. If I move q over to this side, and I get q squared plus n q times x. And to do, this is a second grader. And to solve the second grader, I want zero here on the right side. So I can get q squared minus x times q plus n equals to zero. So here is a second degree equation on the standard format. And let's just, I have to go and check in a book how to solve this. Okay, so it looks like it's on this form. This is general form, a x2 plus bx plus c equals zero. This is how we've written the equation here. We have q squared, that's one times q squared, minus x times q, and we know the value of x, plus n equals zero. So in our case here, in this equation, a is one, b is minus one, c is a known number, and the solution is here. Minus b plus minus square root of b squared minus four times a times c divided by 2a. Okay, then we should be able to calculate x, which in our case is q. Okay, let's do that. Let's see if I can keep everything in my head. Q is equal to, I did the pen and paper calculation wrong. It should be, p and q should be x plus square root of x squared minus 4n divided by 2. It's almost what I wrote, but I wrote 1 instead of x. Yeah. And the other one should be the same, but minus. If you remember, it was x plus minus square root of something. So here we have this. But it should also, this, if we calculate p first, q should also be possible to calculate as n divided by p. And then we calculate this Carmichael number by LCM of p minus 1 and q minus 1 and do the inverse model to calculate d and decrypt the message by take ciphertext raised to d modulo n and print. Print it out. Let's try it. we get something that looks very much like hex. And I could do this. And for instance, XSD. Oops. And we get something that looks like a flag. Yeah, so I actually tried with calculating phi instead, but it didn't work. I had to use the Carmichael constant. So I'm not sure about how the relationship between phi and the Carmichael constant works, really, but you could probably check it out. I wonder what the hint says. I love squares. Okay. Yeah, nice.